So I really just want to close my part with saying thank you for letting us be a part of your story, the story of your families, the story of your vision, your heart for our community, your heart for the world, and know that we take our greatest honor and privilege in honoring your wishes and those intentions in your lifetime and beyond. So now, the part that I know that we're all waiting for, I know I certainly am, I get to introduce our keynote speaker, Mike Mussallem. As I'm sure we all know by now, Mike serves as chairman and CEO of Edwards Life Sciences. Interesting fact, Mike was appointed CEO of Edwards in 2000, the same year that I joined OCCF. So I sort of felt like we've had this parallel journey as CEOs. Although, I don't know if you saw it, but Harvard Business Review just named their 100 best performing CEOs in the world, and Mike topped out at number 15 on that list. It's possible. It's possible he could just be slightly outpacing me in terms of career trajectory, but it ain't over till it's over, Mike. You know, we all know Edwards as a global leader in patient-focused medical innovation, focused on heart valve disease and critical care medicine. I didn't realize that Edwards has over 12,000 employees worldwide, and they are singularly focused on patient needs and have an incredibly strong culture of volunteerism and giving back. In fact, they have a goal that 100% of Edwards employees give back at some point every year, and they come very close to meeting that. In his role, Mike also serves as chairman of the Edwards Life Sciences Foundation, which has granted over $57 million to causes around the world. And Edwards' signature philanthropic initiative, Every Heartbeat Matters, set this incredible goal of reducing the global burden of heart valve disease by educating, screening, and treating 1 million underserved people by 2020, a goal which they literally just met this year, 2 years ahead of schedule. So you can say maybe they could just sit back and think of their next thing for the next 2 years now. True Edwards fashion, they just decide to throw another 500,000 people in and up their goal to 1.5 million by 2020, which is an incredible model for all of us. I know so many of us have admired Mike for his incredible accomplishments as a business leader. He's the most responsive person I've ever emailed with, I mean, including people who work for me and should have a reason to respond to my emails. I'm just saying, there's a reason he's number 15 on the list, and he's like number one on mine for sure. But we've also had the incredible joy and honor of working with Mike and his wife, Linda, in their personal philanthropic journey and watching their commitment, passion, and focus, which has been a constant inspiration. I know it will be when you hear from Mike today. And I just want to share, when Mike and I were emailing, as we do, with his great responsiveness, he shared that this is the first time today that he's going to publicly share more about their private philanthropy journey and what his inspiration is. So this is a very special opportunity, and I feel so honored that he's trusting us with this incredible part of his story. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me give a very warm welcome to Mike Mussallem. Welcome in.
Wow, Shelley is something, isn't she? She brings out the best in all of us, that's for sure. Thank you, Shelley, for all your energy. I think you're the singular reason that so many of us reach higher than we otherwise would have. So it's a pleasure to talk about it. As Shelley said, I have this unbelievable opportunity to lead Edwards, and there's something about the people that join Edwards, you know, in addition to them doing work every day, that has the opportunity to drive just breakthrough technologies that can affect people's lives. We also have this passion of giving back to the communities that we live in. And I think it attracts a certain kind of folks, so I get a chance to work with very special people that are generous in all aspects of their life, and we're very proud of what we get a chance to do. But today I'm gonna pivot a little bit, and I'm gonna talk about more or less my personal journey. And as Shelley said, I don't typically talk about this. I don't think I ever have before. I probably won't again, but thank you for this opportunity. So, So we'll go back to 1948. My mother and father, this was right after World War II, got married. They were, my mother was 37, my father was 41. They had a, they wanted to start a family. They had a bright dream. Their parents were from Lebanon, so they were born in the U.S. and had a tight family and had a dream of, you know, having something very special. This was an Edwards picture. But so they had their first child, and they were so proud. They named him George Richard, kind of a royal name, right? And you could see my mother with her combination of theatrics and great sense of humor announced the birth of the diaper king, right? Couldn't have been more proud parents. As things developed, George just seemed a little slower. They didn't really think anything of it in the beginning. But then as time went on, they got a little bit suspicious, and about a year later, they took him to some specialists in Chicago and found out that George had Down syndrome, right? So this, you know, people didn't figure things out very fast back in 1950. Matter of fact, one of the doctors, I remember my father telling us that, informed my parents that your son is a mongoloid idiot, right? So think about that, how crushing for these proud parents to hear that. And they were so proud of George. And you can imagine that's a kind of a devastating moment for folks at that time. And they go through discussions like, oh, should he be put in a home? And there's places that the state has for these kind of kids and so forth. But like many of you do, like we all do when we get faced with challenges, you make a decision that you're going to step up to that challenge. And we all get faced with tough things, many tougher things than that. But it's how we respond that matters. And my parents responded in this unbelievable fashion. This is not a sad story. This is a super happy story. George turned out to be an absolute gift to our family, just so full of love and joy. Imagine a kid constantly telling you how much he loves you, right? Every single day, right? All the time. Do you still love me, right? So we were raised as three brothers. I was born 2 years later. My other brother was born 2 years, and it was always the three boys. My mother used to dress us alike. She'd put us in stupid hats. She'd teach us to sing for relatives. It was always the three boys. And George was different, but he was never inferior. We were always the same. We got the message from our parents. That was a very clear message. And, oh boy, did we love George. George was always the favorite. We used to try and tease him to say, okay, who's your best brother, right? And this was the hardest question for George because George was not going to pick between his two brothers. But, you know, if you were George, what you always wanted to do was to be like your brothers. That's what you always looked up to. And it was part of what inspired me to make sure that I did my best. When I think about achievement and people that have really done something, I think about what my brother George achieved. He achieved much more than I ever achieved in my life, just considering where he came from. My mother, like other mothers in that situation, dedicated her life to George. So this was a lady that was pretty successful. She was an office manager, which was pretty significant back then. She quit her work and did nothing but work with George, teach him the alphabet, teach him how to spell, teach him how to read, teach him arithmetic, teach him how to handle money. George was slow. It took a lot of work. This was every day. And eventually George developed all those skills. My mother would do something that, you know, others did at that time, which was to organize the other moms, and they created their own association in that area, right, where a place where the kids could go. It started out as a sheltered workshop and eventually turned into a place where they could actually live and go and work in the community. So it was a pretty special time. As George grew up, he was actually in my homeroom class in high school, so I remember being in a few fights. You know, kids would be mean back then. but for, you know, all the wrong reasons, you know, everybody trying to pull themselves up. But it left an important mark on me on just in terms of how you feel about people. George ended up getting married, which was, he was so proud of that. He got jobs, and he first started working in the workshop, and ultimately got a job on the outside, working as a janitor at Burger King. He used to clean up bathrooms. These are the cleanest bathrooms you've ever seen. He was an overachiever in that regard. So just a very special experience for all of us in the family, and he was a favorite for all. So now fast forward to 1974. Graduating from college, and I met what was to become my wife, Linda. And Linda and I had a natural attraction, and we've been together ever since. We got married 2 years later in 1976. One of the things that probably underlying that, you know, made us even closer together is that, sure enough, Linda had a brother, her oldest brother, who was Down syndrome as well, Bob. And the more that I learned about Bob, almost an identical story. So, them not knowing much, her mother completely dedicating her life to Bob, creating an association for the other kids with Down syndrome to come together. They created the shelter called the Friendship Shelter in Ottawa, Illinois. You know, these back then, they were funding this with bake sales. I mean, think about it. What could you make at a bake sale? Maybe $100, but over and over, and they would just work and work to be able to create something special, and their passion was something that everybody felt, and they were not about to be denied. One of the things about Bob, you know, so full of joy, you know, like all Downs kids, totally honest, right? Honest to a fault. One of my favorite stories, Linda and I still do this, is Bob, when he was a young guy, woke up one morning and he had diarrhea. And he went to his parents' room and he shouted in the window, or in the door, he said, "Mom, Dad, I think I have asthma." So, it'll always be asthma in our house. Also, these guys had rituals, right? And so Bob's ritual, Bob was, you know, he did so great. Bob learned to ride a bike, which was really terrific, and so he could ride his bike down to downtown Ottawa, and his ritual on Saturday is he'd go downtown, he'd pick out a 45 record, he'd buy a can of Diet Right soda and a cherry pie, and Bob was in heaven. It's like done. And do not stand in the way of Bob on Saturday because he was going to get his 45 record, Diet Right soda, and cherry pie. Anyway, Linda and I both experienced such great things going through all that together, that now fast forward to us being able to do some things and give back to community. Here we were about 15 years ago where we said we really want to get a little bit more serious about our own philanthropy, know absolutely nothing about it, and I don't pretend to be an expert today, but this is where the Orange County Community Foundation came in. When we thought about that, we said, hey, we want to get this started. We think we know what the theme is going to be. We ended up calling it the George and Bob Fund, right? So our theme is all about Down syndrome. That's going to be the primary focus of our philanthropy, that we would also do things for education because we're big believers that education can help people pull up in the world, and then just plain giving back to our local community. So those are our main themes. Through the help of Todd Hansen and the rest of the gang at OCCF, they really helped us think about it more rigorously, more strategically, thoughtful. You can't do everything. Think about what you are going to do and really make a difference. Of course, we thought back on those places that our parents helped start, like the Association for Retarded Children in Gary, Indiana, and the Friendship Village, and we still support them. We thought back to the physicians. It was so interesting. So when my brother George became an adult, it was hard to find a good doctor for George, and we ended up coming across these two doctors. One was just a general MD practitioner, and another one was a psychologist, and they had a specialty practice just for Downs adults. And they ended up being fabulous at this because they saw these common themes and trends and so forth with the people that they were treating. And we were so struck with this that we thought, wow, I wonder if that's something else that we can support. So we've been very supportive of that group, and that group today is working on a website and an app to be able to educate other physicians that maybe only see a Downs person, one out of a thousand, that don't really know the special care that they might need. So we have had a chance to do a lot of really cool things. I'll talk about Glenwood House in a minute. One of the things that we did from an education standpoint is to be able to start 529 plans for many of the extended members of our family, and we have a pretty extended family, to be able to do some scholarships. And also at my own alma mater, we sponsored and did a lead gift for them to be able to create a new student union where I went to school, and certainly I wouldn't have the opportunity that I had today if it wasn't for that. So it's been a wonderful opportunity for us to give back, and we probably couldn't have done it if it wasn't for the Community Foundation. One of the things we got out of the Community Foundation, in addition to some good advice, was some really wonderful affiliations. We got a chance to meet other people that were ahead of us on the journey, had better ideas that we could team up with, people like the Thompsons, people like the Beals, the list goes on and on. You learn a lot from that, and you learn a lot about philanthropy and how if you work together with others that you can do even more than you can do by yourself. And it's one of the powerful things that we learned. One of the things that they turned us on to is a place called the Glenwood House. So the Glenwood House is right here in our community here in Laguna Beach, and it's converted. Yeah, where is that? Where's the woo-hoo? Faith and Janet run the place. It's amazing. So converted what used to be a motel on Pacific Coast Highway to a place where folks with special needs can actually live and go to work in the community during the day and come back and have a place to live in a very supportive climate, and it becomes their home. So they have, I think they can handle up to about 50 residents at this point. And we've been passionately involved. My wife Linda in particular has been passionately involved with them most recently. So Linda does interior design. She's really good at it. And they would need to upgrade their dining facility and their recreation facility. And so Linda got involved, put the arm on every contractor we ever used for the last 15 years and say, come on, how about helping? And we've gotten unbelievable help. And it's been really fun to watch that joy. You see me at dinner with one of these guys, and I've forgotten his name, I feel terrible, but he was a great guy. I was asking him in that picture, I said, I heard it's your birthday. Yes, it's my birthday. When is it Saturday? Yeah, it's Saturday. What are you gonna do? I'm gonna have a party. How old are you? I have no idea. I mean, how precious, right? Cut it out, but if those little things can't bring you joy, then nothing does. So it's been an incredible opportunity for Linda and I to be engaged with the community, to do some things from an educational point of view, but also, and most importantly, be able to do something for Down syndrome, and something that we care deeply about. The George and Bob Fund is something that we're most proud of, and we're not done yet. We're still thinking deeply on how to have even more impact. It's interesting, there's some researchers right here at UC Irvine, actually, that are drawing the connections between Down syndrome and Alzheimer's. Both of our brothers have actually passed away at this point. They passed away about 58 years old. Both of them went through this period of Alzheimer's toward the end of their life, which makes it tough. But nonetheless, the joy that they brought us was something that was very special. So just maybe a little bit in conclusion, some of the lessons that we've learned is the kind of stuff that Shelley talks about every time she talks to us, which is to find your passion, right? Find those things that matter to you. I know I'm talking to a group of people that talk about preaching to the choir that already have all those passions and already do so many incredible things for our community. And I can tell you, I'm as a member of the community, I'm very thankful that you do all the things that you do. But the other things that end up mattering are to work together, for us not to necessarily get in silos, to find out how to team up with other like-minded people, how to do handoffs, how to multiply our gifts together, our work, how to make it personal from the standpoint of not just your checkbook, but your time, your effort, your energy. Those kind of things make a huge difference. So I feel like I'm on a learning journey myself on this. I've learned an awful lot from just being around the Community Foundation and from the talented people that work there, and especially the talented people that come to be on their board, be involved, and actually use them as a resource. I think we all learn from each other in that way. So I'm going to conclude at this point. You know, talk about coming full circle. One of the things that the Edwards crew did with Glenwood is to help work with them on their Christmas card this year, which was to build this gigantic sandcastle with Glenwood on one side and Edwards on the other, and that's a team of the folks that did that. Yeah, that's a heart. I know, it's kind of crazy that you could carve that out of sand. These are some pretty talented folks, but you know, it's those little things of working together. The Edwards team, I'm very proud, you know, has adopted Washington Elementary School, which is very near Edwards. So here, Edwards is a very successful company with big glass walls and so forth, and not far away in Santa Ana is a school where kids need a lot of help, right? And they're really living in a totally different world, and we've tried to do our part to be able to help lift them up. I think we all have those opportunities in our life, and I know that you all are probably exemplified the best examples of that. We're in the heart business. I would love to be able to actually measure hearts in this audience. I think sometimes the kind of stuff that we do quantitatively could never measure the quality of the hearts in this room. Thank you all for listening. Yeah.